Hey everyone, a very good morning to all of you. Myself, Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. So guys, before beginning this video, which is going to be a lot important for you, for your phase one, also for your understanding of the major reports. So before starting this session, let me inform you that you all can download the PDF of this session via the Telegram channel, and the link of that Telegram channel is in description below. So now let's begin with this first question, which is about the World Inequality Report. So we have many interesting facts coming out of this report, so we will be looking at all of those. So let's begin. What is the female labor force participation ratio, ratio or rate, basically, as per the World Inequality Report 2022? So here the right answer is 18%, but here there is a omission that it is about India. Okay, so what is the female labor force participation rate in India as per the World Inequality Report 2022? The right answer is 18%. So here guys, this report has been released by World Inequality Lab. This organization is based in Paris. So whenever you cover any kind of report, you need to know that which organization has released that report, because the importance of the report sometimes is attached to the organization which is releasing that report. Okay, so this is an important organization, and the lead author of this report is Lucas Chancel. So this is also another preliminary fact that you should be aware of. Now this report assesses the inequalities inter-countries, inter-regions, intra-countries, intra-regions. Basically, the report has not focused much upon intra-regional inequalities. Rather, the focus is on inter-regional inequalities as well as intra-country inequality. So you will understand this thing when we will discuss about the case of India. Okay, so within one country, we have so much inequality. Within countries, within regions, we have so many inequalities. So that is the basic premise of this report. Now let's understand what are the facts that have been given out in this report. So first of all, the very startling fact that this report has pointed out is that the level of inequality in the world has reached the level which was seen in 19th century, which was seen in the 20th century, basically the 1900s era. Okay, so that was the time of imperialism, where some countries were gaining a lot of wealth by leeching off the other countries, the poor countries. And similar kind of inequal situation we can see in 2021 also, and this is a very alarming situation. Wealth inequality. So 50% of the global population holds only 2% of the global wealth. So this is again a very unequal situation. The top 10% hold 76% of all the wealth. So this top 10% include all the millionaires, billionaires of the world who have a control over the 76% of the global wealth. Region wise, Middle East and North Africa region has the highest inequality in wealth distribution. So here you can see that within this region, you will see that the top 10% of the population, the richest population of within MENA region, have a hold over majority of the wealth, okay, in comparison to the bottom 50% of the population. So this is the graph, this is the basically chart that shows the inequality. So this blue indicates the bottom 50% of the global population. This green portion shows the middle income people, and this red shows the top 10% richest people. So here you can clearly see, this is income, this is wealth. So I hope that you know the basic distinction between wealth and income. Income is basically what you earn. Okay, wealth is something that includes your assets as well. Income is basically a flow concept. You can measure your income during a period of time. Therefore, you have annual packages. So you say that 6 lakh per annum is my income. Okay, but wealth is a stock concept. You can measure it any point of time. Okay, that this much is the value of assets that I hold at this point of time. So this is wealth, this is income. This is the basic distinction. And income wise, you can see that the top 10% hold 50% of the global income, whereas the bottom 50% of the population hold only 8.5% of the global income. Rest is with the middle income, basically the population which is in the middle. So 39.5% of the global wealth is there in this strata. When it comes to wealth, only 2% is held by the bottom 50% of the global population. When it comes to global 10% of the population, 76% is the wealth held by them. And the remaining people, the 40% of the global population which lie in the middle income category, hold 22% of the wealth. Now here, middle income are not very important because they are in the middle. Obviously, middle income earners are not very important for anyone. So I'm not saying this very very realistically. I'm just saying it sarcastically. So the focus areas are either the richest one or the poorest one, who actually gain a lot of attention. So here again, we have to focus on the inequality in relation to the middle, in relation to this highest earners, or in relation to the bottom 50% of the global population. So I hope that this concept is clear. Now, as far as the female labor force participation is concerned, or we can say the income earned by females via labor work, labor includes both blue collar and white collar jobs, okay? So I'm not only talking about the manual labor, blue collar jobs, it includes white labor as well. So overall, it has grown from 30.6% in 1990 to 34.7% in 2015 to 20. During this huge period of time, the increase is very marginal, okay? Women make only 35% of the global labor incomes, men make the remaining 65%, we can see here clearly. Okay, so it is approximately 35%. Female participation has increased across all regions except China, which has shown a decreasing trend in female labor force participation. Okay, now the next inequality is in terms of ecology. So here, ecological inequality refers to the emissions, the per capita emissions, region-wise, country-wise, and globally. So we all know, in light of the COP26, it was a very hot topic that the COP26, many countries were forcing India as well to reduce its CO2 emissions, and African countries as well. Then this issue came up that we are the ones who contribute the least to the global emissions, and the industrialized economies are the ones who contribute the most. Still, the burden of reducing the carbon emissions is being equally shared, and this is injustice to the developing and underdeveloped countries, okay? Like India. India is also a developing country. So if the burden of reducing CO2 emission is equal to in comparison to US and China, then it would be unfair to us because it would definitely impact our industries. So globally, the top 10% of the world's population is responsible for 48% of the global carbon emission. In contrast, the bottom 50% contributes only 12% to it. So here we have the global per capita inequality in terms of emissions. This chart denotes the global carbon emissions. So here you can see this is East Asia, Europe, North America, South and Southeast Asia. So here within the region as well as inter-region, you can make comparisons. Okay, so let's take the example of North America. Here within North America, the top 10% are emitting 73% of the global carbon emissions. Okay, whereas bottom 50% are responsible only for 9.7% of global carbon emissions. Now come to South and Southeast Asia. You can see the difference here. In North America, we have the world's most developed country, that is USA. Now, in South and Southeast Asia, what do you see? The industrialized economies have developed by emitting a lot of carbon already. And now, if both of these regions are asked to reduce their carbon emissions to the same quantity, then it would be unfair to this region, to the economies that are lying in this region, because they have started to develop now. And if you put a barrier to their development at this stage, then it will not be beneficial to these economies. Okay? Now let's talk about India's scenario. So first of all, India is a very unequal country. We have a lot of inequalities. Top 10% population holds 57% of the national income, and the average household wealth stands at 9,83,010 Indian rupees. Okay, the gender inequality. The female labor income share is equal to 18%, which we need to increase to 50%, which is significantly lower than the average of the Asian region. So entire Asia's female labor force participation is 21%, and India is performing lower than the Asian average. Okay. Now, this Asian average does not include China, because as I told you in the beginning itself, that China is showing declining trends in terms of female labor force participation. So here we have counted Asia but excluded China. Okay. Now, the labor force participation rate that India has presently is one of the lowest in the world. Not the lowest, it is one of the lowest. Okay, so pay attention to this thing. Now comes private wealth. So private wealth increase seen in India over the time period over from 1990s to 2020. This is the graph. This is the numbers that you can see. From 290% in 1980s, the income rise, the private wealth rise percentage is 560% in 2020. So that is the increase in the private wealth. Now, what are the reasons that this report has cited? So majorly, there are many reasons, but the major reason that this report has cited is the liberalization, the globalization. So these two initiatives worldwide, not only in context of India, worldwide have led to an increase in opportunities, but that too were grabbed by only a limited amount of people. That's why these inequalities have risen. Now, apart from this, many suggestions were also given by this report, like we should introduce the progressive taxation on the wealthy people. We as in the entire globe, not only India. Okay, so progressive taxation and other equal distribution of wealth by the state, and such kinds of measures have been introduced by this report, which are not very important from our perspective of phase one. Therefore, I'm skipping those. But these are the facts that can be asked from you in your examination, so prepare them well, thoroughly. Okay. Coming to the next question, what is India's score in Asia Power Index 2021? So here the right answer is 37.7. First of all, Lowy Institute, which is an Australian think tank, this has released this Asia Power Index, and it is only the organization which releases this index. Okay. So this is an important index. 26 countries are assessed. US holds the top position. Now, those who are listening to me very attentively would see this anomaly. Like, we are talking about the Asia Power Index, then we have counted, why we have counted US in this index. Now, Asia Power Index, as in which country has the most influence, most power in the Asian region. So that is the meaning of Asia Power Index. Not only the countries that are there in Asia would be counted in this index only. No, the countries that have a major influence, that is, those countries are counted. Okay. China, Japan are at the second, third position. India is at the fourth position. Total 131 indicators were used, which were divided into 8 domains. And we will be looking at the domains alongside the rank of India in each and every domain. Okay, so very first we have economic capability. Okay, so economic size and attributes with the most geopolitical relevance. Here India has fourth rank. मिलिट्री केपेबिलिटी इंडिया हैज फोर्थ रैंक, रेजिलियंस इंडिया हैज फोर्थ रैंक, फ्यूचर रिसोर्सेज तो अगेन इंडिया हैज हियर इंडिया हैज थर्ड रैंक नॉट द फोर्थ रैंक. ओके नाउ दीज स्कोर्स आर नॉट इम्पॉर्टेंट फॉर यू टू मेमोराइज, सो डोंट क्रैम योर माइंड विद अ लॉट ऑफ इंफॉर्मेशन बिकॉज इट विल अगेन डिटेरियोरेट योर परफॉर्मेंस. सो यू डोंट हैव टू मेमोराइज दीज स्कोर्स, यू कैन जस्ट मेमोराइज द रैंक ओनली. नेक्स्ट पैरामीटर इज इकोनॉमिक रिलेशनशिप्स, एट्थ रैंक. डिफेंस नेटवर्क्स, सेवेंथ रैंक. डिप्लोमेटिक इन्फ्लुएंस, फिफ्थ रैंक. कल्चरल इन्फ्लुएंस, फोर्थ रैंक. सो दीज वर द रैंकिंग्स ऑफ इंडिया इन ईच एंड एवरी पैरामीटर ऑफ द इंडेक्स. नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज विच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग इज पार्टनरिंग विद नीति आयोग फॉर ई सवारी इंडिया इलेक्ट्रिक बस कोलिशन. सो वी हैव कन्वर्जेंस Energy Services Limited, World Resource Institute, Rocky Mountain Institute, only A and B, only A, B and C. So which do you think is the right option here? The right answer here is option B. Pata nahi kyun mujhe aisa lag raha hai that majority of you are going with option E, but here, right to your surprise, the option is B. So Convergence Energy Services Limited and World Resource Institute, both of these are the institutions that are partnering with NITI Aayog for this initiative. Now what is this initiative? This initiative basically aims to increase the adoption rate of e-buses, electric buses in India. That is the whole purpose of this initiative. Now how are they going to increase the adoption rate? Basically by creating awareness about the benefits, about the technicalities involved in adopting the e-buses. So that is the how part, that how are they going to achieve their function or purpose, and this is the why part, why is this organization formed. Now not only the Convergence Energy Services Limited and World Resource Institute India are partnering with NITI Aayog, this Transformative Urban Mobility Initiative is also partnering. So this is the third partner of NITI Aayog in this coalition. Next question is, who has won the 57th Gyanpith Award for the year 2021? So, Damodar Mauzo is the right answer, okay? Now, we have two Gyanpith Awards, 56th edition and 57th edition. So, both of these awards have been given simultaneously. Therefore, they both are in the news. So, what is your task here? You have to carefully read the name of the poet and the literature with which he or she is associated, along with the edition of the award or the year. Okay, so these are the boxes which you have to pay attention to. Okay, so let's first discuss the 2020 award. So Assamese poet Nilmani Phukan Jr. has won this 56th edition of Gyanpith Award. And Damodar Mauzo, who is a Konkani novelist, he has won the 57th edition of this award, which was given for the year 2021. So do pay attention to the boxes that I have drawn. Next and the last question, which is very important. So let's discuss this question. What is the criteria for assessing large dams under the Dam Safety Bill 2019? So first of all, this bill was passed by the Lok Sabha in 2019 only. This bill has recently been passed by the Rajya Sabha also. So Parliament has given its nod to this bill. Now it is given to the President for his assent. But right now, this bill has been passed by the Parliament and it holds a very major importance from your exam point of view. Why I am saying this, you will get to know when we will discuss this in detail. Now, first of all, this dam safety bill has been introduced to ensure the safety of the dams, okay, that are already existing and provide for the structure and standard procedures for the dams that will be constructed in the future. Now, as far as the existing dams are concerned, the dams which are higher than or the dams which are of 15 meters of height will be assessed under this dam safety bill, or basically the dams which are 15 meters higher or above that height, they will automatically come under the scrutiny of the government by virtue of this bill. Now, what is there in this bill? Let's discuss that. So, dams which are 15 meters high and dams which are between 10 to 15 meters will also become eligible with some applied conditions. Now, what are those conditions? You don't need to go into them. Now, the most important part of this bill is that it provides for the constitution of four bodies, and those four bodies are very, very important. Okay. So, the very first body here is National Committee on Dam Safety. I guess it's a little blur on the screen, so bear with it. I'm going to read out each and every word so that you don't miss out on the part that is written here, and you don't have to worry about it as well, because the PDF is available for you, so you can read out from the PDF as well. Now, as far as the organizations that are being formed under this bill are concerned, so the very first organization is National Committee on Dam Safety. Okay, so this National Committee on Dam Safety is basically the policy making organization. Now, this will be formed by the government once this becomes an act. Okay, this will be headed by the Central Water Commission's chairperson. It will have 20 members, 10 from the central government, 7 from the state government, 3 experts who are already working in the field of dam safety. So this makes it to 20 members, excluding the chairman. So if you include the chairman, then the constitution of this group is equal to 21 members. Okay. The purpose is to frame policies for dam safety procedures, for dam safety standards. Large dams located or operated by two or more states will be under the jurisdiction of this body. Now, guys, this is the bone of contention here for the states, because water is a state subject. Okay. You must have heard about the Kaveri River dispute. Now, you have to tell me that which two states are involved in the Kaveri River water distribution dispute. So, this is a very long standing issue that is there, and this is between two states over sharing of the river water of River Kaveri. So, if I know that majority of you would know the answer, that this issue is between which two states. So, do mention it in the comment section below. So, here the point of contention, the bone of contention between states and center is that center is trying to impeach the power of the states. Now, you will get to know this thing once we will be done with this entire table, with the entire organizations that are being constructed or constituted under this bill. So, that's a little bit of suspense, so keep it. Now, move on to the next organization, which is National Dam Safety Authority. Now, this authority will be the implementation body. Okay, this one is the policy making. It will make the standards for dam safety. This organization will implement them. Okay, now it will be chaired by additional secretary rank personnel in the central government, and this will basically perform the functions of providing technical assistance to state dam safety organizations, resolving matters between the state dam organizations of two or more states, or between any state dam safety organization or the company which is constructing that dam. If there is a dispute between both of these entities, then also this organization will resolve it. It will also provide accreditation to various dam related inspection agencies. Now, these are the two state organizations that will be formed under this bill, or basically by virtue of this bill. So, State Committee on Dam Safety. It will basically supervise the state dam rehabilitation programs. It will review the work of the state dam safety organization and review the progress on measures recommended in relation to dam safety, among others. Purpose of this, we have other organization, that is State Dam Safety Organization, and the purpose of this organization includes keeping perpetual surveillance, inspecting and monitoring tab. So this is again, this basically is the monitoring and reviewing agency at the level of policy implementation. This will work at the ground level, and at the ground level, it will monitor the functioning and construction of dams. Here, the point from where the dissent arises. The bill gives the power to the central government to amend the functions of these two state organizations. So from here, the entire dissension is emanating between the state and the center. Okay, so that's the issue that is there, which can be relevant from your interview point of view or from your ESI point of view. So you can clearly read that out from the various articles that are out there regarding the bill and the controversies related to the bill. Okay, now the another important provision that this bill has is the extended producer's responsibility. So here, what do we mean by extended producer responsibility? This means that the producer is not only responsible for the product, but for the maintenance of that product is also the responsibility of this producer. Okay, so under the EPR, dam constructors or the dam owners will be responsible for the safe construction, operation, maintenance and supervision of a dam. Dam owners need to create a dam safety unit for each and every dam that they construct. How many dams are there in India? So there are around 5,700 large dams, of which 80% are already 25 years old, and nearly 227 dams are over 100 years old. So this data has been picked from the PID. Okay. Now guys, I hope that you know about the DRIP project. That is Dam Rehabilitation and Irrigation Program of the central government that was launched in collaboration with World Bank, only for ensuring the safety of the dams and rehabilitating the older dams. Your task is to tell me the total budget of this project, because three phases of this project have already been launched. So to tell me the cumulative budget of this initiative. And here this video ends. If you like the content, then do subscribe and hit the bell notification. Thank you so much, guys.